We were talking about diagnosis for Lacan, we were talking about diagnosis in Lacanian psychoanalysis, and we had spoken a little bit about speech. You could say, as soon as we're talking about speech, we're also talking about the big other, and hence, continuing with our reference to Dany Nobus, we're going to ask how the concept of the big other enables us to do some diagnostic work. What is a kind of important and kind of nice experience with Lacanian theory is sometimes if you've come to the concept of the big other or jouissance through other different types of theory, you know, you come through political theory or you're thinking about how the other works within ideology, it suddenly comes as a kind of happy surprise that these concepts are there, you could argue, largely for diagnostic purposes. So as we'll progress, we'll start to ask how jouissance informs a diagnosis, and what we're going to do right now is think a little bit about how the notion of the big other informs a diagnosis. So I've really quoted Dany Nobus a couple of times, but here's the next quote. It's going to build on the idea that we diagnose via speech, but we also diagnose via the notion of the big other. So we've already seen Lacan arrives at the key insight. We're on page 12 of Dany Nobus. Lacan arrives at the key insight that in psychosis, the other is excluded. What that means then is that communication has lost its dimension of the unknown. For a psychotic person, nothing is unsure within what is being transmitted. Sentences are unidimensional. A word does not carry any other meaning other than that which is presented by the word itself. There's a kind of concreteness of the word, a kind of literalness of the word, of the signifier that I tried to illustrate in the previous lecture. So this is interesting as well, because one of the rules of thumb, although one should be careful to not to overgeneralize it, one of the rules of thumb in thinking about diagnostic structures is that neurotics vacillate. They doubt. They're uncertain. They're unclear. Whereas, on the other hand, psychotic subjects are often sure. They have certainty, which is precisely, I think, what Nobus is alluding to when he says communication has lost its dimension of the unknown. So that would be an interesting diagnostic indicator or marker. If the person who is speaking to you is thoroughly convinced of the literal applicability and certainty of what is being said by themselves, that sounds a little different from how we would normally experience the vacillation, the uncertainty, the ambiguities of neurotic speech. So let's move on now. We'll come back to jouissance. We're trying to foreground the notion of the other. Lacan makes this kind of strident assertion, which I think is nevertheless truthful and important. In the domain of neurosis, you could say that every neurotic subject recognizes and is being recognized by the other. The question of the other and the other's desire is of paramount importance for the neurotic subject. Hysterics, and I'm again borrowing from Nobus, take the other to task for tampering with their enjoyment, for stealing something precious from them. Now bear in mind, this is not necessarily something that is completely conscious. You could say this is an unconscious orientation in the world, that the big other has stolen something precious from me, the big other is someone or should be taken to task for this infringement. Now, of course, there'll be multiple situations where something of that kind of structural relationship to the big other, and in this instance, jouissance, will be fairly evident. But it's important not to necessarily pinpoint it only at that level. It's a structural and, in many respects, unconscious orientation. The obsessional, by contrast, is constantly striving to minimize the power of the other and the other's desire by neutralizing the other, and indeed precisely by neutralizing the other's desire. When we start to elaborate a little bit more in the sessions on obsessional neurosis and hysterical neurosis, I will go into this in much more detail. But for the time being, we're just trying to get a flavor of what's being spoken about. One way I've tried to think about this idea of the obsessional constantly trying to annul the desire, the lack of the big other, is by speaking of various strategies of lack avoidance. I'm a good example. I'm always like, I can read all of Lacan. It'll take me 5 years, but there won't be anything that I didn't get. And don't worry, Lacan can explain pretty much everything. Don't worry, it's okay. There's no lack here. I don't want to be surprised by some unseemly desire or lack of my own or someone else. The point being, though, that the other is positioned in terms of the other's desire, and in a way, how the other is problematic for taking something away of my enjoyment in the case of hysteria, and the other is problematic for the obsessional in as much as one doesn't want to admit that the other either desires or lacks, or indeed that I might have some desires that may be disruptive. Now, we've already seen this idea of the other being excluded. Now, if the other is excluded, that presumably is going to introduce a kind of particularly important type of relationship to the other in the case of clinical work with psychotically structured subjects. So let's go to the quote. We're on Dany Nobus's book. We're still with him, and we're looking at page 21. He makes this point. Psychotic people, he says, are governed by an exclusion of the other and by a vision of a transparent counterpart, little other. In general, he says, psychotics do not testify to a degree of ignorance about what is happening to them or about what is going on in the world. On the contrary, they act upon a firmly established knowledge, a deep-rooted conviction, and massive certainty. It's the end of that quote. This seems to be a very different general orientation to the other, to what one would normally find within the case of neurosis. Nobus goes on and he says, if we're thinking about the other, the big other, is a diagnostic criteria, we should also bear in mind the moment within seminar 11, towards the middle of Lacan's teaching, where he starts to talk about the other as the subject supposed to know. We've mentioned this a couple of times. There's multiple different conceptual elements to this concept of the big other. We can even admit that they don't all add up, but the concept has multiple uses and applications. And in seminar 11, one of them is to say that there is a transferential dimension to the big other. What do I mean by that? Well, the clinician seems to know something about psychoanalysis or something about my symptoms. That's partly why I go there. Hence, there's this idea for Lacan that the big other, in this instance, the clinician themselves, represents the subject supposed to know. Now, you could see why that kind of transferential relationship would be important to set in train, to set in action when the neurotic subject arrives at the clinic. Because why else would they come if the analyst didn't know something? And of course, if they think the analyst does know, they start to wonder, well, have fantasies and ideas about what it is that the analyst knows. Why are they so important? So on and so forth. But now, of course, we go back to the idea that the big other is excluded in the domain of psychosis. So if the big other is excluded, then presumably that idea of the subject supposed to know won't work for the psychotic. So let's go back to Nobus. Psychotic patients, he says, have no reason whatsoever to invest the analyst, or anyone else for that matter, with the function of the supposed subject of knowing, the subject supposed to know, since they already possess and are possessed by all that there is to know. Whereas neurotics are desperate to find someone who masters the knowledge that they themselves lack, psychotics are adamant that there is nothing more to discover than what they already know. When they address themselves to an analyst, they are not supposing her to be a subject of knowing, but rather someone who will understand and authenticate their experiences. So again, we're pointing to a very important structural difference in how a key concept in Lacanian theory works within clinical work. And here we have the situation where the big other, as the subject supposed to know, doesn't work. Or put differently, this is a way of thinking about how the analyst should locate themselves in the clinical work, not as the person who seems to know, not as the subject supposed to know, because as we know, that doesn't really work for the psychotically structured subject for whom there isn't a subject supposed to know because they themselves already know it. So to begin work with neurotically structured subject, it would be presumably a good idea to get something of that subject supposed to know function happening if it hasn't already. Whereas in the work with a psychotically structured subject, one wouldn't want to do that. One wouldn't want to do that, A, because it wouldn't work, or because it might have very bad effects. It may kick off some kind of paranoid reaction, for example. But here's a further idea. What that means then, and here we have an ethical implication, a treatment implication. How should the clinician position themselves in the work with a psychotically structured subject, or particularly a psychotically structured subject who is experiencing a triggered psychosis? One should avoid at all costs gravitating towards the position of the master, gravitating towards the position of the psychical detective, gravitating to some kind of caricature of the psychoanalyst or of the Freudian detective of the unconscious. One wouldn't want to do any of those things. Rather, one should position oneself as a kind of secretary. So there's this famous quote that Lacan throws out somewhere, and he says, the analyst, in the case of psychosis, should position themselves as a kind of secretary of the mad. Of course, I don't like the mad bit or the insane bit, that language. But the idea of the secretary is important, because what that means then is it's not that the analyst is the subject who's supposed to know and that they are thereby hystericizing and getting the neurotic patient, the neurotic analysand, to question, to wonder, to question this enigmatic thing I've just said. Rather, the analyst positions themselves as the person who needs to know, as the student of, or the witness, as someone who can recognize the experiences, which are often, let's face it, fairly troubling, of the psychotically structured subject, particularly one who's triggered. Lacan's comment, though, has a little bit more nuance to it. It's not just that one is the student of the psychotically structured client or analysand. It's not just that one is the witness, although one should be those things too. The secretary has a kind of particular job. The secretary is one who will remind the person of something that they've said before that maybe they've forgotten. The secretary is someone who might implicitly give a little bit more structure by repeating things back, by asking if they heard them correctly. And in all of those kinds of interaction, which of course leads us on to thinking about what are the techniques that would best enable me to position myself as the secretary of the person who's coming to see me. In all of those ways, one is avoiding positioning oneself as the subject supposed to know, but rather as the subject who might benefit from hearing, from witnessing, from listening to what the psychotically structured subject has to say. So that seems like a good point to draw to a conclusion. And what we'll do in our final session is talk a little bit about how jouissance gives us some kind of diagnostic indicator in working with those three structures of perversion, psychosis, and neurosis.